X-Men 97, Season 1, we've come to the end. It's the last of our impromptu discussion episode reviews of a single episode. We're probably going to come back and do a postmortem of everything, but right now we're talking about the finale, the extra-sized finale. It was 40 minutes, and even then it felt like there could have been more. But let's discuss what was there. And of course, as always, let's get out of the way right on the bat. Spoilers, because we're going to be discussing a whole bunch of things, and there will be spoilers.
See me. The future's tide.
So when it came to X-Men 97, a lot of talk about leading up to this finale you may have heard was, will it stick the landing? I've been enjoying it so far, but will it land? Because that could change a lot of things, because there were a lot of potential avenues the show could go down, which for some may make or break. And that's probably still the case. Whether or not this stuck the landing is probably a miles may vary kind of deal. For me, it felt like it did stick the landing, even though there were some moments that felt very Deus Ex Machina-y or Deus Ex Phoenix-y. But on the whole, there were a lot of solid character beats, a lot of things that were paid off. It depended upon the character you were, though. People fared very differently than others in terms of this. Some people got a lot of attention and a lot of growth, and it felt like things moved in a certain direction, whereas others, it felt like it just didn't, or like part of their arc was acknowledged but not the other. Looking at you, Cyclops.
I lie because the truth is we're nothing like you. Thank God, because it's the only reason you people are still alive.
So Tolerance is Extinction Part 3. It saw the conclusion of the battle with Bastion and Sinister, and as well as the confrontation with Magneto. We left off at the end of Part 2 with Fatal Attractions, the skeleton rip off of Wolverine.
Magnus, for the love of God, don't do this!
Panel being redrawn in this new 97 style. And we picked up with something which highlighted a little bit of, it's not an issue with the show, but it does feel like sometimes it throws those big comic book moments out there to showcase them, and at times it varies as to whether or not they are as firmly planted inside the story itself. It makes some moments feel like they lack weight without prior knowledge. Also, continuity, when did he get the helmet off? Last time we saw Charles, the helmet was on his head, blocking him from accessing Eric's mind, and now he's just in it.
Charles, how shockingly far you've fallen. Yet also so predictably.
Charles messing with people's minds, a tradition. The first time he catastrophically mind-wiped somebody was issue 2 of X-Men. Uncanny X-Men issue 2, 1963. The Vanisher. R.I.P. the Vanisher's mind. A decent amount of this episode is dedicated to Charles and Eric's relationship, and it's quite compelling. There's a lot worked through here. There's some light retconning of Charles and Eric's backstory, but there's been a lot of that throughout the 92 series and the 97 series. That's not uncommon for this series. It just alters some of the details about how they revealed their powers to each other. This episode, if you're a fan of Charles and Eric's relationship, which I very much am, this episode has a lot for you. There is a lot there. Mileage is gonna vary on how it lands for you.
I'll drown.
I have you, Magnus. I'll always have you. Even if I'm pulled under too.
There's a lot of discussion about what happens with Charles violating Eric's mind, which in the comics was the lead up to Onslaught. They do handle it differently here in that Eric isn't just entirely left shut down after it, which is to this storyline's strength.
You hurt me as you did me. Countless times.
But there's lots of debate, and you could already see it, as to whether Charles had to do it or not. It's the same debate you'll see around the EMP, because everybody in this is messy, which I appreciate. It makes everything very complicated. There are lots of different discussions you could have about actions people have taken.
This is what she was protecting me from. I massacre you freaks and you're recruiting me?
And to me, that works in the series' favor. But again, some are gonna lean more one way or the other. But that's part of what makes a presentation like this very rewarding and fun. It allows fans to have those discussions, even though the creators, especially Bodomeo, do weigh in. However, that doesn't mean you can't keep having those discussions.
Sir, King T'Chaka is right. We know next to nothing about Asteroid M. This could do more harm than good.
There were some moments in Magnus's mindscape when Charles is trying to help him rebuild his mind, which again, you could take a couple of ways. You could take it as a heartfelt moment where finally they're working through Eric's trauma, which he's never fully gotten a chance to entirely address.
This is the dark pain you've carried inside all these years. I have these waters too. So many do.
Or it could be a horrific moment, because, well, it already was horrific when Charles pushed himself in there, but more horrific in that maybe he's making Eric into the person he wishes he was. We'll see where it goes with that, or if it even touches upon that at all, because there's a line where Charles talks about his powers could allow him to do that, because Charles has terrifying powers. There's a reason he has to live by such a strong code of ethics, because if not, the world just remade in his image. Magneto tried to do that with the tech circuitry in his helmet one time, but then he was stopped when he saw the purity of Captain America's mind. Captain America came off looking pretty good in this. That was nice. There are a lot of cameos, which cycles back to the time spent inside of Eric's mind, wherein there is this moment that for me felt a bit odd and really highlighted how much they have pushed the Rogue Magneto relationship, even though it's very much been retconned into this series, not to the comics, but to this series, to the point where when they're showing off the people who are keeping Eric anchored, the people who help keep him grounded, you see his three children and Rogue, and that just felt very much like they had pushed that to the fore, perhaps more than was warranted. You let me know what you think. Also, don't put her there next to his children. That highlights the age thing, which was already something people had issue with. Now, in terms of other characters, not all of them got as many moments. There were some strong moments for Scott, Jean, and Cable.
They're good eyes.
And now they're yours. I love you, son.
But when it came to, say, the final moment for Morph and Sinister, it didn't feel, say, as earned.
Show me. Show me my face.
Looks the same to me.
At least not in this series. That relied heavily upon prior knowledge from the 92 series, which some will have, and for them the moment may land a bit more. But for others who came to this series independently, it may not have that same punch, which is something I have seen in comments, people saying that they came to the show just independently because of the things they'd heard. Word of mouth. And then maybe they would work their way back afterwards, but some of them went back and tried to watch the 92 series and found that it was just not to their taste or too old. You know, mileage varies. I said that so many times. That is the phrase of this video. There was this odd moment also, which, well, two things. Firstly, it was paraphrasing the whole Wolverine is the best at what he does. What he does isn't very nice. But also there was this whole don't break her heart moment from Scott. And it was like, wait, this isn't Krakoa. We're not there yet.
Don't you dare break her heart. Be the best at what you do. Heal.
Now as for Bastion, there is definitely going to be some people discussing whether or not they feel like his arc was complete. Not in terms of it having a beginning, middle, and end, but in terms of it having achieved its full potential or not. He certainly had some very cool action scenes, cool transformation. He went full Dragon Ball Z, perfect Cell at the end there. There was a wonderful interplay with Cable's techno-organic arm, which I highlighted in one of the earlier episodes that they were drawing it a bit tentacly, and they did it. They went for the Cable tentacle thing and acknowledged that it's not really an arm, but a life form that Cable is telepathically suppressing. They played a bit more with the parallels between the mutants and Bastion, between Bastion's thought process and some of the other thought processes like Magneto, but also with the contrasts. His moments were fascinating.
People are good. Too damn good.
So they did do a lot there, and Bastion allows the X-Men to have their big aspirational hero moment, where they have to make that decision between whether they're going to seek vengeance, which is something that a lot of people would want, or if they're going to try and live by that more difficult path, forgiveness.
Bastion, grab on!
Seeing them do that, it very much works in terms of your aspirational heroism, and for some it's very inspiring what they want from their heroes, while others may find it frustrating, and they may feel that the show has veered, because some were very much hoping it was going to go heavy, Magneto was right, end the Earth. Some of the comments were just like, the end of people, humans boo! In some ways, Bastion felt elevated from his comic counterpart in this same storyline, and the fight scenes with him went incredibly hard. The show did commit to the idea that mutants are replacing humans, and they did not reconcile the idea that they are the same species.
Humanity is going extinct.
No, they're having babies, and more of them like us.
It's one of those things where the X-Men can work very well as an illusional property, but a lot of people push them more towards the allegorical, which is the direct one-to-one comparison versus the more abstract comparison. And when one does that, moments like that don't land as well. There are things that don't work perfectly for allegory, but work better from a more removed capacity. Although again, that's something that people debate very heavily, passionately, and at times scarily. Bastion did get some more moments to shine as a master manipulator in that having Magneto there was revealed to be so that he would be pushed over the edge and then Charles would have to stop him. So there was some, I did it 35 minutes ago, but they didn't really bother highlighting that so much. But it was a nice touch because it kept him from being a bit more of a one-note techno villain. Although the show also did veer heavily into fear the technology. Machines are to be feared. And some of the lines veer towards a bit silly when they kept calling him the future incarnate multiple times.
My God. Cooley, he is the future.
Although that may have been literal, we'll see. This episode, we got to see a bit more of what was going on in the world, in the post-EMP world. It does still feel like they were downplaying the EMP a little bit, but it was nice to see the heroes doing things. Some of the moments made me chuckle. Doctor Strange in his full regalia doing surgery. I don't know why, just that image. There's one moment with Cloak and Dagger where Daredevil just busts in behind them, almost like he's trying to be in the shot, even though he already had a whole sequence where it was, look, the Daredevil. There is also this moment that for some canonizes the idea that Peter found MJ because you see Peter and MJ standing there. So for some, they felt their hearts shatter as they wanted to see more Spider-Man. But you never know. We'll see what the future holds. This is one of those moments where, depending upon how immersed you are, how much you're enjoying it, you may hone in on and pick apart. One for me was when Sunspot had to catch Jubilee. Where I was like, weren't they in space? There's nothing to protect. She's dead. Poor Jubilee. I'm sure someone's gonna put an explanation of because of his mutant power configuration of the bite, but it was one of those things I just thought about it.
What will you do, child?
I must say, I was just on the edge of my seat for this episode. I found it very exciting. It was one of those ones that definitely needed that space and rewatch before I came to talk about it so that I could be more in a headspace to note some of the moments where I was like, wait, what? But overall, still very enjoyable both times. A very solid conclusion to the plot as they laid it out, even though there are of course things that could have been done differently or threads that would have been interesting to see pulled on. I still think Valerie Cooper could have had so much more. I was really attached to the Mystique headcanon theory. I'm still putting it there, or the Bastion sister theory. They had the same colors. Why would you do that? Don't just do it because it looks cooler, because it shows visually that they're on the same side at the moment. More depth, more. I need more. The Cyclops arc felt a bit incomplete in the resentment side of things. On the fatherhood side, he got a lot to do there, and the family arc really came together. I nearly cried at the scene where he got to show his eyes to Nathan. However, when it came to resentful Cyclops, Magneto was right Cyclops. It felt very much like they just brushed past that, especially in between parts 2 and 3, where we go from him blasting Charles to blaming Magneto. The way in which time travel was utilized at the end here was clever. It could have very much been the rewind method, which is not what they went for. They went for breaking up the teams in time, because here's where we are. Charles hijacked Magnus's mind so that he could reverse the EMP, and then he set about putting him back together. The X-Men were able to fight Bastion to a standstill, and they were at the point of join us when the humans down below decided they were going to put into place Operation Magneto, which is nukes, Operation Generic Plan. And so the X-Men had to once more fight to save a world that hates and fears them. And at the end of that, they were all transported to different moments in time. And there's a question as to whether Bastion survived or not. It was played in a way that he could be dead or he could not be. It depends what you want to do. I maintain that it's good to keep villains around so that you can trot them back out if you need to. Keep it a little ambiguous. He had all the tech. We can rebuild him. Well, he can rebuild himself. He has the technology. So we ended up with the teams split. Some still in the present on Earth.
Must be a damn fool walking in here like we're friends.
Oh, we're friends, Daniel. Just not yet.
Some way in the past and some very far in the future. But all the different points in time connected by Apocalypse. Apocalypse at different points in time. We're gonna have to deal with a lot of Nathan stuff with the Ascani. And then we're gonna have to deal with En-Sabanur in Egypt. That was another moment where I paused and I was trying to remember if they'd ever called him that in the 92 series, but if you're familiar with the comics, it's like, En-Sabanur, Apocalypse. Also, the lips, the very distinctive blue lips. We also had a post-credit scene, which has people feel in some kind of way. It was the foreshadowing of something that people have been calling for Gambit's return and him returning as Death, one of the horsemen of the Apocalypse. There's also some guesses as to who the other horsemen will be, because some are guessing already based on X-Men they didn't see that maybe it's Storm, maybe it's Wolverine, and just lots of people excited for season 2.
Oh,
Oh dear.
I want to know where you stand on that. Are you one of the people who were excited? Did this finale land for you? Did it not? Were you really disappointed? Did you feel that they didn't stick the landing at all? What parts did you enjoy? What parts did you not enjoy? How do you feel about the series overall, this season at least? On the whole, this season was very much a love letter to the 92 series, the X-Men series in general. It tried really, really hard to honor the original tone, feeling, comics, a lot of it, and a lot of it landed.
Indeed, the odds remain reckless. But if we all work in perfect unison, we may just spare our world a dinosaur's fate.
It was clearly plotted from beginning to end, and so the things it introduced, most of them it wrapped up, except for the things that was trying to lead into season two, or avenues that it didn't appear to think of or it didn't want to go down. Because again, there were lots of theories out there. And that's fun. It's really fun when you have a series that elicits that kind of fandom. There were also some wonderful music beats in this episode and the series overall. They play some really downbeat, operatic feeling X-Men theme, and it really works. I'd play it, but YouTube would hurt me. They played a little bit with Morph and Wolverine because they had done those interviews about how their relationship is really special, but it's not too different from what you saw in the 92 series, only they state some things explicitly.
She can't say it, but I can.
I love you, Logan. Stay with me.
If I had to sum up this episode, I would just say it was very exciting, dynamic, and a lot of fun. It was interesting. The players felt in character. They were distinct. They had contradicting plot lines. They bounced off of each other with their differing personalities. They felt like the X-Men. Now, some weren't thrilled as they felt that some of their faves didn't get a lot to do. Morph was just a cameo machine. Wolverine just kind of sat around till they needed his skeleton ripped out. Personally, I didn't feel like Life Death, the arc for Storm, where she regained her powers, packed as much of a punch as it could have. Everybody has their beats that they feel were stronger, weaker. I'm really excited to hear what they were. It was just a really fun ride, a fun week-by-week experience. Looking forward to watching it all again, looking forward to enjoying all of the X-Men comics that it got me excited to read again, curious to ponder some theories for season two, fingers crossed that season two is as enjoyable, maybe even better. And now I want to hear from you. That was rambling all over the place. What did you think? X-Men 97 season one finale episode. Let's discuss. Put all of your thoughts. I can't wait to hear from you. And while you're down there, please do all the YouTube things. Like, share, comment, subscribe, hit the bell notification so that you never miss a vid. Thanks so much for taking some of your day to spend discussing comics with me. I always appreciate it, and I will see you again soon. Bye-bye.